right here, 1 Corinthians 3, 16 to 17, do you know, do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? Verse 17, if anyone defies the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. Praise God. Do we all have that in our Bibles? So it's not my word this morning, it's the word of God. Jesus clears the temple. So Jesus made this entry to Jerusalem and he went straight to the temple. And so we're not talking about the temple of building this morning. We're not talking about building this morning. You are the temple of God. That's a reminder that I want to tell this morning before I move on. You are the temple of God. I am the temple of God. So God lives in us. It was before, and even before, it was just the shadow of God that lives in those things, just for him to assure the people that he's still with them. So it wasn't like God himself lived inside any building, the Ark of the Covenant and all that. It was just a symbolic of God's presence. So I'm going to do something very quickly. If you're here, you've never surrendered your life to Christ, whatever I want to say this morning doesn't make any sense to you. I'm sorry, I'm saying maybe what you don't want to hear, but the book of Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, the Bible says, Jesus stands at the door of your heart and he's knocking, and he says, if anyone hears my voice and opens the door to me, I will come in and sit with him and dine with him. Praise the Lord. All eyes closed, all head bowed, if it's not too difficult for you to do, please. If you're here this morning, you've never surrendered your life to the Lordship of Jesus. It's not about, oh, I was born into a Christian home. Oh, my mother is a Christian. It's not about that. You've never at any point in time surrendered to the Lordship of Jesus. Can you just raise your hand up? If you're here like that this morning, you've never surrendered to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, do you mind raising your hands up? Praise the Lord. We are all born again. We are going to heaven this morning. All eyes open. We can raise our hands up again. Can we give the Lord a big hand? Hallelujah. Now, Jesus clears the temple. Now, it is not enough to allow Jesus into your life as you've done before now. That's not enough. Praise the Lord. That's not enough. It is more important to allow him to live with you. Like I said, this message this morning is not for unbelievers. It's actually for Christians, for believers. Praise the Lord. So it is not enough to allow Jesus into your life. It is more important for you to allow him to live with you. So that you come to church every other Sunday does not mean that Jesus lives in you. That you join yourself, you know, I think I preached a message here one time. There are some Christians, I call them the coffee Christians. That's what I call them. They can take you everywhere. They're taking you from this restaurant to another restaurant. You're taking coffee. They're telling Jesus loves you. Jesus, I know that Jesus loves me. What more? So following people that just keep telling you God loves you, there is more about Jesus. There is more about God. There is more about the kingdom of God. So when we tell you to come to church, look, if you come to church, I'm happy. Like I told us, this is my own office. So whenever you come to church, I'm happy that I have people in my office. Praise the Lord. Amen. God is my boss. Amen. But more importantly, coming to church is for you. It's not for me. So if you think maybe when you come to church you make pastor happy, you're making a very big mistake. Very big mistake. Like I said, I'm happy when you come. That's the truth about it. That's why I said, you might have heard about Jesus and claim to be a Christian. It doesn't mean that Christ dwells in you. You can go on every day calling the name of Jesus. It doesn't mean Christ dwells in you. What he showed us this morning. You may have the appearance. It doesn't mean that Jesus lives in you. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5. The Bible says that they have a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. What it means is that there is nothing traceable to God in their lives. That's what it means. Don't forget my title this morning. Jesus clears the temple. I'll say it again. Don't hide in the crowd. If you know you don't have any relationship with God, don't let this service pass you by this morning. The purpose of the temple was for people to come and worship the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But now that purpose has been structured, changed for another thing. Right? They are buying and selling in that place now. So that temple could no longer be used for its purpose. So this is what this is saying this morning. If you call yourself a Christian and God does not live in you, there is no way you can fulfill purpose.
Amen.
That's what it means. The people will normally go to the temple to worship the Lord, but now something else has filled the temple. And so the people could no longer worship God anymore, making the temple to lose its purpose. So any temple, because of us, God will not stay where they are buying and selling. So any temple that has lost God out, that temple can no longer fulfill purpose. God did not save you so you can go to 9-to-5 job, get money to pay your bills, feed yourself, money noon and night, and buy nice clothes, buy nice cars, build nice houses. There is much more to why God is keeping you here.
That's right.
There is much more. But you know what? If you don't have God on the inside of you, living with you, living with you. So sometimes some of you can come to church service and God has blessed you so much you felt a visitation of God. But building your temple is filled with irrelevant things. God cannot live with you. So it's not enough to have God's visitation. It is much more important to have God live in you.
Amen.
Live in you. Praise God. So when Jesus comes into your life, if you allow him, if you allow him, because God respects your choice. So the first thing God does is to clear your life, cleanse your life whenever it comes in, to get rid of everything that will not allow him to stay. Don't forget, you can call yourself a Christian. In fact, you can fall under the anointing, sometimes maybe to impress the pastor. Sometimes you can be loudest, you can be the loudest in worship, maybe to impress the pastor. It doesn't mean that God lives in you.
That's right.
It doesn't mean that God lives in you. You can play the piano, you can play the drums, you can set up equipment, you can do anything and everything you feel like doing. It doesn't mean that God lives in you. Doesn't mean that God lives in you. And let me tell you something. God can use anything anytime. There's a song by Alice Scott that says that you can use anything, Lord. You can use me. See Alice Scott, I can't remember. It's one. God can use anything. So God can use you yesterday and forget about you today. If he doesn't live in you. Praise the Lord. Oh, I hope I'm not offending some people this morning. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So, what God does first is to cleanse, to clear your temple. Hallelujah. So, like I said, it's if you allow him. He knows his thoughts towards you and everything works together for your good. So, cleaning your temple and cleansing your temple would never be comfortable. It's never going to be something that you love. It's never going to be something that you like. It's never going to be a pleasant time. Because some of us, that's the problem. When we come to church and God is speaking to us, you know, I never say this, use this phrase. That's just me. That's just me. That's just me. You know what you're saying? Jesus, I don't need you. I'm okay with me. That's very common. Oh, that's just me. That's just me. That's just the way I am. Some of us use that phrase. It's a wrong phrase to use. If you want God to live on the inside of you, because the Bible says Christ in us is the hope of glory. I think 1 John 3:2, the Bible says that when he appears, we We shall be like him.
So it's not meant to be me. It's meant to be Christ.
That's just me. That's just me.
Very common to a lot of us.
He's coming in today. You need to allow him to clean and clear your temple. Are you going to allow him to deal with unforgiveness in you? Some of us, we're dealing with unforgiveness. We have bitterness in us.
And no,
he has to come and apologize to me. She has to apologize to me. I'm never going to. I need to prove something to him. I need to prove something to her. That is not Christ-like. And if he's living in you, you have to allow him to deal with you. So sometimes God will ask you to go and make a request from someone very young or younger person to you. Don't be like this. Let him deal with you. Praise God. Let me tell your neighbor, say, let God deal with you.
Let me say, let God deal with you.
Some of us are heady. Some of us are lazy. God is not lazy. God is always working.
Amen.
He's always working. It's after he had walked and he saw that everything was good, then he will set the seventh day and say, let me rest on this day. And that's why we have the 7 days in a week. So stop being lazy. Let God deal with you. Some of us like to procrastinate. What you have to do now, you don't want to do it now. The Holy Spirit is whispering to your heart and say, pray. What's it mean? He said, oh, I'll do it later. And then days are going by, weeks are going by. You don't pray anymore. You don't fellowship with God anymore. God wants to clear your temple. Some of us have ungodly friends. You know what God is speaking to you, but you can't just let those people go. And God keeps speaking to you when you never let them go. He wants to clear your temple this morning. He wants to clear your temple this morning. Hey, like I said again, I'm saying it again, the purpose of the temple is for people to come in and worship God. But if going and selling can't make God stay in the temple, then people can't come in and worship. So whatever is not of God in you, whatever is not of God in your life, whatever you know that, you know, it irritates the presence of God. The book of Habakkuk chapter 1 verse 13, the Bible says that the eyes of the Lord are too old to behold any iniquity. The eyes of the Lord are too old to behold any iniquity. Praise God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I hope I'm not wanting people this morning. Maybe we're expecting that it's Palm Sunday, so we're just going to be singing praise and dancing to it. Of course, yes. But this is very important this morning. And this is what God is saying to us this morning. It's never going to be pleasant. Whenever God wants to clean you up, it's never going to be pleasant. It's never going to be pleasant. Another thing God wants to do, I'm going to share one scripture with us before I talk about this last thing here. I want us to look at the book of, like I said, I'm talking to Christians this morning. I'm not talking to unbelievers this morning. So if you haven't come into the faith, I'm still encouraging you. I'll try to make that call just by the end of this message. Praise the Lord. The book of Ephesians chapter 5, chapter 4 rather. Ephesians chapter 4. I'm going to read from, it's going to be a little bit long, verse 25. To 32, but I want to pay attention to everyone this morning. Answer, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. He's saying it again. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. So, what determines Jesus living in you is not coming to church. What determines Jesus living in you is not professing that you are a Christian. What determines Jesus living with you is not dressing. We have some people in Nigeria who call them the scripture. You ask you, they will tie your hair, they will do everything, don't wake up, don't nothing, and everything like that. I think so, Jesus. That does not determine if Jesus is living in them. Praise the Lord. What determines Jesus living in you is having his commandments and keeping the commandments. That's what determines if Jesus lives in you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So I'm going to make this call again. Revelation chapter 3 verse 20. Jesus is calling to you this morning. If you know that you don't have a relationship with him, would you mind? I'm not even going to see anybody should close their eyes or anything right now. It's the best thing to do. It's the best thing to do. If you're here this morning, you know you don't have a relationship with Jesus. Do you mind raising your hand? I'm going to pray for you.